Let's bring in the jury.
Please stand for the jury.
Yesterday, when we ended, we were at the point in time on June 4th, late afternoon, early evening hours, when you were about ready to depart. You were telling us before you departed, you were going to, or you and Mr. Alexander had decided to engage in this photo shoot, you called it, right?
Yes.
And this was to take place in his bathroom, right?
Yes.
Okay. Why was the shower area selected?
It was selected for the water. We were going for a certain effect with the pictures and the water.
Okay. When you were in the bathroom, you took these pictures with Mr. Alexander's camera, you were telling us yesterday, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. And where was your, refresh our memory, where was your luggage and your items, your personal items, when you were doing this photo shoot?
Well, I think my camera had been put away. I didn't really even bring it out for that part of the trip. So I don't recall specifically, but I think most of my stuff was in the car at that point, maybe except my purse.
Okay. When you were in the bathroom, did you have a gun with you?
No.
Were you holding on to a knife?
No.
Okay. So we saw the pictures of him in the shower. Tell us what happens once he gets in the shower.
I'm taking pictures of him. We were trying out different poses. We were kind of
communicating. Is it?
Yeah, we were kind of laughing.
Okay.
It was, I don't know, it was a little weird because the background wasn't that great, but the water was okay. And we were trying out different poses, and then we were checking the photos and deleting them, and then taking a few more and checking them and going through them and deleting them. And at one point, he was sitting, and I was taking pictures. I was probably a few feet from the shower so that the water didn't get on the camera. And I was showing him the photos, and we were deleting some. And at one point when I went to delete the photos, as I moved the camera, it slipped out of my hand. And I went to, it didn't like fall right away. I kind of caught it, and then I caught it like a football, like it bounced, and I almost caught it. But it didn't catch it, and it landed on the mat, and then it rolled onto the tile.
And where were you when this took place relative to the shower?
I was crouched by the shower. I might have been on the mat or on the edge of the mat.
Okay. So what happens after you drop the camera?
At that point, Travis flipped out again, and he stood up and he stepped out of the shower and he picked me up. I was crouching, but he lifted me up as he was screaming that I was a stupid idiot. And he body slammed me again on the tile. He told me that 5-year-old can hold a camera better than I can. He was, as he was screaming at me, there was spit coming out, or maybe it was water, but I was getting wet, and when I hit the tile, I rolled over on the side and started running down the hallway. And I don't know why I didn't run out of the room, I ran into the closet because the door was open, was my thought. The last time I ran down the hallway, he caught me before I got to the door. And that was another incident in the summer. So I guess I went into the closet. And
what, do you mean, let's talk about that. What do you mean this summer incident? What incident were you referring to?
There was an incident where he was really upset. The whole incident?
Well, yeah, what happened?
The previous summer in August 2007, I got hired at P.F. Chang's to work, and they needed my social security card, which I didn't keep in my purse because it, for security reasons, it was packed away. And I was looking everywhere for it, couldn't find it, so I assumed it was in one of the boxes that were in Travis's garage. So I called him. I needed the card for the next day for work. After I'd been looking for it, I wanted to come over and look for it there. He said, sure. It was a brief phone call. It was about 11 o'clock at night. And he sounded sleepy, so I thought maybe he was sleeping. I came over. I went into the side, of course, to go into the garage to look for the box. But this time, instead of going into the garage, the door was locked, which was unusual because it's almost always open. So I think, no big deal, I start walking around the back of the house toward the sliding glass door, which is never locked because he had installed a doggy door. So the sliding glass door butts up to it, but it doesn't lock. So as I was walking around the house, the blinds to the living room were open, and I could see this blue glow coming out of the window from the TV. And I was walking toward the glass, and I glanced in, and I noticed two people making out on the couch. And I stopped for a second because I thought that was awkward. And I assumed it was one of his roommates, so I thought, how would I handle that? You know, I thought maybe I'll just walk in real quick and say sorry, and just because I would have to walk past them to get to the garage, because it was on the couch. They were on the couch, so I decided I would do that. And then as I was going toward the glass, she stood up and she rehooked her bra, and the guy stood up wiping his mouth, and I saw it was Travis. So we weren't together at this point, and I knew that there were other people that he was seeing or that I was maybe seeing, but it kind of still hurt, so I ran. I didn't go to the, I didn't go get my social security card. I just left, and I went home, and it was too late to call anybody, really, so I just waited till the next day to call my sister, my little sister, but she wasn't home. She lived with my parents at that time. My dad answered, and I told him what happened because he was somebody to talk to. I didn't confide in him often, and he was asking me why I was crying. And so I just told him what happened. And so at that point, I decided I'm just going to go over there and ask him if he's dating someone. That way I can move on or something. So I went over to his house, and I went into the house, and he was in the laundry room, stenciling stripes down the walls, getting ready to paint them. And I hopped up on the washing machine and sat there. And he came down on the ladder and he gave me a kiss. And I just said it flat out. I said, if you're dating someone, it's okay, you can tell me. And I told him, based on what he had said about Deanna in the past, I said, I won't freak out the way Deanna does, because he had said that about her. And he just thought that was a strange question. And he said, why are you asking me?
How does this, without saying what was said, you mentioned that this correlated to the incident on June 4th. Were you in the upstairs area with Travis after this argument about seeing him with another girl?
Yeah, he just let out a real frustrated scream, and he walked out of the laundry room and palmed the wall really hard with his palm. I mean, not the wall, the door frame of the laundry room, and just went upstairs, and I sat there kind of stunned. I'd only seen his temper a few times at that point. And I heard this thud, this banging, like rhythmic, over and over and over, like just, it was dull, and something was like hitting something over and over and over. So I jumped off the washing machine to see what it was. He was the only one home. So I went upstairs, went into the bedroom. It was getting louder as I got toward the bedroom. And then I turned to look down the hallway, and he's banging his head repeatedly on the linen door closet. And it was awful to watch him do that. And I walked up to him sort of tentatively because he looked unstable. And he was mumbling something under his breath and he kept saying...
Okay, just what, you mentioned, did you have to run away from him that day?
I finally said his name to get his attention, and he screamed "what" really loud, and he spun and looked at me like a madman, and it freaked me out, so I ran down the hall thinking I would just get out of the bedroom, but he caught me right as I reached the threshold of the bedroom, right when I reached the carpet, he caught my wrist and pulled me back, and I was freaking out, but then he calmed down, and he explained to me that she was just a girl that he met in Phoenix, and they probably wouldn't see each other again.
Okay. Moving back to June 4th, before we continue on the story, I want to get talk to you about a couple of exhibits. The first being Exhibit 160. You see that? You look at that? Was that a picture that you intentionally took?
No, it wasn't intentional.
Okay.
It got deleted.
Looking at Exhibit 161. Was this a picture you intentionally took?
No. That I didn't take that one.
Showing you exhibit number 159. To your recollection, is that the last picture you intentionally took of Travis Alexander?
I took it intentionally. I don't know what order they went in.
Okay. When he slams you down onto the ground, after you drop the camera, how do you feel?
I was scared. I was thinking crap because this is, it's everything that I was trying to avoid downstairs when he started getting mad. I was doing everything I could to avoid that, and I still didn't avoid it. I still screwed it up, and now he's pissed again. So he's freaking out, I'm freaking out. I rolled, like I said, I rolled off to my left and began to run down the hallway, and I could hear him follow, I could hear his footsteps chasing me.
Were you scared when he was chasing you?
Yeah, I didn't want him to grab me again.
What were you scared that he would do?
Who knows? At that point, he had already almost killed me. I wasn't thinking when he almost killed me before that I was going to possibly die. I was just thinking I couldn't breathe. No air, that's all I could think of before I passed out. But it was later on that I realized that I could have died if he just held on to my neck a little longer. So I didn't want that to happen, obviously. So I ran into the closet and I slammed the door, and I intended to run through the opposite end of the door because it has another exit. And as soon as I got in there and began to run, I remembered where he kept a gun. So I grabbed it. I jumped up on the shelf, kept it on the very top. I grabbed it. And then I ran out the other door as he was opening the door, and he ran, chasing me, and I turned around and pointed it at him so that he would stop chasing me.
Jodi, I want to show you what's been marked as exhibit number 70. Do you recognize that area?
Yes.
What is that?
His closet.
You said that you grabbed the gun from the closet. Can you point to us where the gun was?
It's not shown in this picture, but it's at the very top of the shelf, up like right here.
Okay, let me
show
you.
But it's above that.
Let me show you then. It's been entered as Exhibit 69. Does this show the area from which you grabbed the gun?
Yes.
Could you point to that for us, Jodi?
It was up here in the corner, kind of up, right up there.
Okay. You told us that you knew the gun was there. How did you know that?
I had known he had it. I found it one day when he used to give me projects when I would clean. Sometimes it was the floorboards, sometimes it was the light fixtures, and this day it was the closet shelves. I had to pull everything off the shelves and dust it all. So I got onto the top shelf. There was, I don't know if it was shown in that picture, but there's also a seat. So I moved the seat around to stand on it to get up there, and it was up there.
Okay. So you told us that you grabbed the gun and got out through the closet, correct?
Yes.
I want to show you what's been marked as Exhibit 162. Jodi, how do we look at that picture, please? How do we get to that point in time? What happened between the time you grabbed the gun?
I don't know how that picture was taken.
I'm not asking you how the picture was taken. I'm asking you what happened at that, in between the time you grabbed the gun and what we see here. What happened?
When I grabbed the gun, I ran out of the closet. He was chasing me. I turned around and we were in the middle of the bathroom. I pointed it at him with both of my hands. I thought that would stop him. If someone were pointing a gun at me, I would stop. But he just kept running. He got like a linebacker. He got kind of low and grabbed my waist. But before he did that, as he was lunging at me, the gun went off. I didn't mean to shoot him or anything. I didn't even think I was holding the trigger. I just was pointing it at him. And I didn't even know that I shot him. It just went off, and he lunged at me, and we fell really hard against the tile toward the other wall, like kind of near the scales or whatever those things are. So at this point, I didn't even know that if he had been shot. I didn't see anything different. He was just, we were struggling and wrestling, and he's a wrestler. He had wrestled in high school, and he was getting on top of me. And I didn't want him to get on top of me, because when he had done that in the past, I can't get out of those holds that he gets. So he's grabbing at my clothes, and I got up, and he's just screaming angry. And after I broke away from him, he said, "Fucking kill you, bitch." And
before he lunged at you, was he yelling at you and threatening you, to your recollection?
Well, he was chasing me, and he was pissed off.
Okay. Do you remember him yelling or saying anything?
He was calling me names because I dropped his camera.
Okay. Do you remember what those were?
Well, I remember him calling me a fucking idiot. And I remember him telling me that a 5-year-old can hold a camera better than me.
Do you remember saying anything to him as he lunged at you?
I don't think so. I just was crying and running, and I pointed it at him, assuming that he would get the idea that to stop. He wouldn't stop.
What do you mean he wouldn't stop?
Well, Well, after the gun went off, I thought, oh, crap, because now he's really going to be pissed. I didn't know that I shot him. I thought I shot a hole in the wall or something, and I'm thinking he's really going to be pissed at me now. So now he's telling me he's going to kill me, and I think after he said that, he had almost killed me before, and
and what?
There's a lot of that day that I don't remember. There are a lot of gaps. I don't remember the poses of the pictures. I remember them now that I've seen the pictures, but I didn't remember them until I saw them. I remember taking pictures. I just don't remember the pictures themselves, even though we looked at them. And now I see them, I remember them.
Well, let me ask you this. Getting us back to that moment in time, not the poses, anything else. You've told us that he said, kill you, bitch, and you were underneath him trying to get away.
He said that right after I broke away from him.
Okay, right after you broke away from him. Once you broke away from him, what do you remember?
Almost nothing for a long time. There are some things that have come back over years. But nothing, I don't know if those are things that I'm thinking of from before or if it's that day. It's confusing. There is like a huge gap. Like, I don't know if I blacked out or what. There's a huge gap. And the most clear memory that I have after that point is driving in the desert. But there are certain little things that have come back, like pictures in my mind that have come back since then.
Well, let me ask you this. Do you remember stabbing Travis Alexander?
I have no memory of stabbing him.
Do you remember, as we see here in Exhibit 162, do you remember dragging him across the floor?
No. I just remember trying to get away from him.
Showing you Exhibit 73. Do you remember placing him in the shower?
That's no.
You told us that after running away from him, you don't have any clear memories of what happened after that until hours later, right?
I have a few memories, but nothing's super clear.
Okay, tell us about those memories.
I have a vague memory of putting the knife in the dishwasher. But I've put the knife in the dishwasher before, so I don't. I'm pretty sure it was that day.
Do you know where you got the knife from?
It was upstairs.
Okay. Are you assuming that or do you remember that?
I'm assuming that. It hadn't been moved since he cut the rope.
What's that?
I don't think it had been touched by either of us since he used it to cut the rope.
What else do you remember from after the time that you crawled out from underneath him?
I remember I was in the bathroom. I remember dropping the knife, and it clanged to the tile. It made a big noise. And I just remember screaming. I don't remember anything after that. Not immediately.
Do you remember where he was when you were screaming?
I think he was next to me on the floor. I don't know.
Do you know where you were?
I was in the bathroom.
What else do you remember?
Not much.
Not much mean nothing?
I remember more the feeling of that time, not pictures and things that I can bring back.
Tell us about the feeling.
It was like mortal terror. It was like I pissed him off the worst I'd ever seen him pissed off. And then I tried to stop him, and then I pissed him off even more. And I thought, shit, I'd really, really pissed him off. And he was angry at me, and he wasn't going to stop.
What do you mean by he wasn't going to stop?
He wasn't going to stop. He wasn't stopping. He was...
When you say he wasn't going to stop, did you feel that he was going to kill you?
For sure. When he said kill you, yes. He'd almost killed me before, and now he was saying he was going to.
So when he said that to you, you believed him because of past incidents? Why did you believe him when he said, kill you, bitch?
Because he'd never said that before, and he'd taken me almost to that point without that threat, and now he was clearly making that threat.
You told us your last memory in Travis's bathroom was sitting on the bathroom floor screaming.
I don't know if I was sitting or what. I just remember dropping it.
Okay. Dropping the knife?
Yes. I remember what was going through my head. I don't remember anything else after that.
What was going through your head?
That I just couldn't believe what had happened, that I couldn't take anything back, what had just happened. And it was like, I couldn't rewind the clock.
Did you realize all that had happened?
I don't know about all, but I just remember dropping the knife and being very freaked out and screaming.
After remembering that feeling and dropping the knife in the bathroom, and some of the other memories you've shared with us, what is the next point in time for which you have a memory?
From which, that I remember?
Mm-hmm.
I remember driving. I thought I was driving west because I remember the sun was in my eyes for a while. I didn't know where I was going. I didn't have my GPS anymore. I hit a lot of stoplights, so I don't know that I was on a freeway. I hit a lot of stoplights. And then eventually I was in the desert. I don't know where. It got dark.
So you don't remember really even driving, other than what you told us?
Well, that was the first more or less clear memory after.
Okay. Did you have thoughts about what happened?
Yes.
At that point in time, when you were pulling away and driving away, did you have the gun with you?
I don't remember bringing the gun with me, but I remember throwing it.
Throwing it where?
In the desert.
Okay. What about the rope he had tied you up with? Did you take that with you?
Yes.
And do you remember what you did with that?
Eventually it went into a dumpster.
Where?
It was behind a gas station. I think it was somewhere after St. George. I don't remember. It was getting light out, wherever I was parked at that point.
Do you remember? Let me ask you this. When you were driving, was there blood on you?
Yes. There was, when I finally came to, I saw there was blood on my hands. And I didn't have my shoes. I didn't know where my shoes were. I was in the middle of nowhere, so I pulled over. And I got out of my car. I was really thirsty. So I had a case of water from Costco in the trunk. So I got some water, a water bottle. I rinsed my hands off with it as well. I got my other shoes. I had business shoes for the prepaid thing, and I got those on.
When you do this, you have the water, you're cleaning the blood off yourself, and you're... Did you stop and clean yourself up before you disposed of the weapons or after you disposed of the weapons? Or is it all one stop?
Well, I don't remember what happened to the knife, so it wasn't in the car with me. The gun was when I stopped. And the rope was after that. Another stop.
When you got to this point in time then, did you do so with the full realization of what had happened in the bathroom?
I don't know how full my realization was, but I knew that it was really bad, and that my life was probably done now.
At this point in time, did you believe that Mr. Alexander was dead.
I believe that, but because I didn't have any clear memory.
She believed whether he was alive or dead.
Restate your question.
Explain to us if you believed Mr. Alexander was alive or dead. Let me just ask you this, yes or no. Did you believe he was alive?
I didn't know, but I didn't think he was, because I didn't know. I thought he was not alive at that point.
Was there a part of you that hoped he was?
Yes. Of course.
What's that?
I said, yes, of course.
What do you mean, of course?
I wish that it was just a nightmare that I could wake up from. And then just find out that everything was still the same way.
Did you still love him?
Yeah, I did.
Do you still love him now?
Yeah, it's a different love, but yes, I do.
Now, after you have cleaned yourself up and you disposed of the gun and the rope, what do you do next?
I started looking around for the charger that I thought I left, because Matt hadn't answered his phone until he was there, and I started cleaning out the car, and it was under the seat of the passenger side. So I plugged it in. I turned on my phone. There was no reception. As I began to drive, some reception came, like one little bar, and then two, and then one, and then none. And I had, I think I had voicemails. I kept trying to check them, but the reception wasn't strong enough to complete a call. So I don't know if I had text messages or not, but I text.
Why are you interested in your voicemails at this point in time?
Well, I realized at that point that a lot of time had lapsed, and that people would probably be wondering where I was. I realized that it was irresponsible of me to just hang out with Travis, but he always was the priority whenever we got together, and so all my other responsibilities just they went to the back burner. So at this point, I thought, well, Ryan was expecting me, Leslie was expecting me, all these people are expecting me. I don't even know which way I'm going at this point. I don't even know what I'm going to tell them. Maybe I'll say I got lost. I don't know. I'm thinking of all these things. So I finally get to this sign that's where it says Las Vegas is like 100 miles away. So I thought, okay. I had an idea, sort of where I was at this point. And then I came upon the Hoover Dam, and there was a checkpoint there. I had to stop, and then they let me go through it. And on the other side of the Hoover Dam, I stopped again and pulled over. And at this point, I realized I was in really deep trouble. And I started thinking of what I could do to delay the inevitable.
Well, let me ask you about that. Your phone was working then. It begets the question, why not just dial 911 and tell them what happened?
I was scared, and I couldn't imagine calling 911 and telling them what I had just done.
Why not?
Well, I was scared of what would happen to me. I was scared of a lot of things. I was thinking of all kinds of things. My family, myself, what would happen. I was thinking of having to explain that.
Having to explain what?
How the day ended up unfolding. I was just really scared. I was actually very scared going through the checkpoint too. I thought, oh my gosh, they're gonna pull me over and this is it.
Well, you talked about, you said that the people expecting Utah, you to be in Utah, Ryan and Leslie, and you mentioned delaying the inevitable. What did you mean by delaying the inevitable?
I knew I'd messed up pretty badly, and that the inevitable was going to be that it's not something that I could really run from.
You said that you messed up pretty badly, but he attacked you. Why did you feel like you messed up pretty badly?
Because he attacked me, but I don't know. I didn't look at it like that. He had attacked me in the past and nothing happened. Nothing like this.
But it was different this time, wasn't it?
It was different. It was heightened.
Okay. So you felt a sense of remorse about what happened?
Of course, I wanted to rewind the clock and just
what?
So that never had happened. I mean, I was thinking at the time, the camera, if I wouldn't have dropped the camera, but I realized there were probably other steps that could have been taken. Even though he got really mad, and even though he threatened to kill me, maybe I'd have run left instead of right.
So you're regretting not taking alternative steps, right? Is that correct?
Sustained, rephrase.
You were you angry at yourself?
I was feeling a whole lot of emotions. Mostly I was very scared. And I was very upset, and I was very, I don't know, it's hard to explain because I just wanted to die.
Did you contemplate killing yourself at that point in time?
Not that very moment, but yeah, I did it thereafter.
Okay. Well, let's stay in that moment for now. Talk about delaying the inevitable and how you can't run from this. People are waiting for you. What do you decide to do?
I knew that my life was pretty much over, but I didn't want anyone to know that that had happened or that I did it. So I started taking steps or what I could do in the aftermath of it to try to cover up that I was there. So I did a whole bunch of things to try and make it seem like I wasn't ever there.
Do you remember what those things were?
Yeah, when I pulled over at the Hoover Dam, I thought of, well, I had called Ryan at that point and Leslie. And Leslie said we called Travis because we thought maybe he would know where you were, because we know that he still talks to you. And so then she said, I've left a voicemail, and I thought, oh, okay. So they're going to find his voicemail. Maybe I should leave a voicemail. So I called his phone to leave a voicemail. I didn't really know what I was going to say. I just thought, at this point, I told Ryan I got lost, and I told Leslie the same thing. And his voicemail picked up, and I started trying to say that too, but I was crying, and I was trying to sound cheery, but I was crying, and so I would hit pound, and I would listen to that message, and it didn't sound right, so I would delete it, and I would try again, and that one, then I started crying in the message, and that one didn't sound right, so I deleted it, and I would try again, and then I was talking too fast in this one, or I started crying in that one, so finally I'm frustrated that this call is a long time, and I hit pound again. I erased the message by hitting 3, and then I started recording it again, and then I listened to it that time, and I was like, okay, it's good enough, I'm going to leave that, and so I had that message sent.
So this was your effort to try to act as if you weren't present in Mr. Alexander's home on June 4th?
Yeah, I figured that eventually his voicemails were going to be listened to, and I thought that'll just, you know, throw the scent off for a little while, so to speak.
Okay. So after you make these calls to Mr. Burns, Miss Yudi, and Mr. Alexander's voicemail, what do you do next?
Kept driving past Vegas.
Where were you intending to go?
I realized that in order to keep up that pretense, I had to keep part of the schedule that I was sticking to, so my intention was to show up in Utah, make an appearance, and go home.
Okay. And showing up in Utah, was that for the business meeting that we had heard about earlier?
Yeah, whatever was going on that day. It would have been a briefing, I think. That's
and
what I went to.
The overall intent of going to Utah was to spend time and get to know Ryan Burns, right?
That was the whole purpose for the trip, initially. Okay. That and to see places on the list and for my photography.
All right. So when you were driving from the Vegas area to Utah, did you contemplate what sort of behavior Mr. Burns was expecting out of you when you got there?
Yes, I was contemplating what kind of behavior anyone would expect out of me, which would just be the same me, or normal, or trying to act like my same happy-go-lucky self that I tried to always be.
So, as it relates to, and I'm going to ask about just a couple of people because we've seen them throughout the course of this trial, how did you try to act in front of Leslie Udy that would be quote-unquote normal?
Just positive, not emotional.
Okay. And what about Ryan Burns? You'd exchange flirtatious text messages with him, heard about this being a budding romantic relationship, at least from his perspective. What did you feel like acting normal would mean with Mr. Burns?
I didn't know. Just hanging out and trying to act like, oh, I just got lost, you know? And I'm kind of dingy anyway, because when I did, everyone thought, oh, that's just Jodi. So I thought, okay, that's good.
She's explaining why in her behavior, Judge.
Overruled. You may continue.
So, I don't remember what I was saying. I just was trying to act like myself. And.
Well, what did that mean with Mr. Burns? Did you contemplate what expectations he might have based on your previous dialogue?
Yeah, I didn't, I guess. He didn't expect sex or anything like that.
Judicial speculation.
Sustained. In your opinion, when you were contemplating what he would expect out of you, was sexual intercourse something that you thought he would be expecting from you?
No, it's not anything we discussed.
Was physical contact of a sexual nature something that you thought that he might be expecting?
No. I don't know about what you mean by sexual.
Well, let me ask you this then. I'll put it more directly. Do you think, in your efforts to appear normal, do you think that he might have been expecting you to, the two of you, to kiss?
Speculation as to, again, what he might have expected.
It goes to her perception. I'm not asking his. I'm asking hers.
All right. With that understanding, overruled. Answer.
Yes.
Did you feel as if he had the expectation that this time together would be romantic or romantic?
I don't know how romantic. I just was going with the idea that we would just hang out and have fun and get to know each other and see if there was any spark there or not.
When you were in Utah, did you kiss Mr. Burns?
Eventually we kissed.
Did you cuddle with Mr. Burns?
Yes, I went to sleep.
Why?
Why did I go to sleep?
No. Why did you kiss and cuddle with Mr. Burns?
Well, I showed up at his house. He had given me directions there. We were hanging out, watching a movie. I was laying on, I don't know if it was a couch or a bed or what, or a love sack, I can't remember. It was just furniture in his room. And we were watching some, like, scary movie, I guess. And he was laying next to me. We weren't, like, really touching, but we were kind of laying next to each other. And I don't know, I felt safe right there, and I figured, like, if I don't kiss him at all, I guess I just wanted to seem, like, normal. I wanted to seem like I was okay, like things were okay, like I didn't just do what I just did.
And that was a pretense you kept up for about a day or so with Mr. Burns?
I had gone to the restaurant earlier with him, or I followed him there. I went to the business briefing, and then I needed to get on the road. It was Thursday night, and I had to work on Friday. I don't know, I just needed to get home. So I went back to his house, we set the alarm, and I think I slept for 2 or 3 hours, and then I got back on the road.
You mentioned going to the briefing and the restaurant and driving around with Mr. Burns. Do you recall hearing the testimony of Officer Galletti?
Yes.
And he had pulled you over for your license plate being upside down. Do you recall that happening?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I remember that.
Okay. Did you put your license plate upside down?
No.
Do you have any idea as to how that happened?
I had told Ryan that...
Objection, hearsay, speculation.
Approach.
Let me ask you, before Officer Galletti pulled you over, did you know that your license plate was upside down?
No, I did not.
Do you have any reason to suspect how your license plate might have got upside down?
I could only think of two things. One, I rented it that way and didn't notice it. Or two, when I'd stopped at Starbucks in Pasadena. When I was walking toward my car, the parking lot was packed. It was dark, though. Obviously, the parking lot lights were on. As I was walking toward my car, there were some skaters, young kids, that were skating. They were kind of snickering and skating away from the car. And I didn't think anything of it. But as I got into the car and began to back out of the parking space, my headlights hit something bright, and I realized it was reflective, so I got out just to check what it was, and it was a license plate, and mine was just removed. The license plate had bugs all over it, and the car that I just rented had bugs all over the grill except where the license plate was, so I just said, oh, this is my license plate.
Let's clarify here, because just to be clear, are you talking about this license plate you saw, one that was on the front of the car or the back of the car?
It was on the front.
Okay. So your rental car had two license plates, to your recollection?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. All right. So at that point in time, did you notice your rear license plate being upside down?
No, it didn't occur to me to check it.
Okay. And when or after Officer Galletti pulled you over for having a license plate upside down, Did you yourself have the tools necessary to correct that problem?
No, I didn't. I was going to ask the owner of the restaurant if he had a screwdriver. So then Ryan, I guess, did it for me. Okay. I didn't have any of that to do.
Okay. After you said you slept a few hours at Mr. Burns, his residence, before you got back on the road to Yreka, did you kiss him that morning before you left as well?
Yeah, we kissed goodbye. We had fallen asleep on the love sack, and we woke up when my phone went off with the alarm. And we kissed. Okay. I mean, we weren't like making out, not like he said. But yeah.
Okay. So after you leave Mr. Burns' house, you're still in your rental car, correct? I mean, you're driving your rental car back to where you're
going? Yes, I was.
Okay. And this would have been a day, day and a half later that you returned to Wairika, right?
I was driving back early Friday morning, hoping to make it on time to Wairika for my shift at 4 o'clock.
Because you were expected there, right?
I was expected there, and there's nobody, it's a small restaurant, there's nobody else that would, I don't know.
Okay. Well, let me ask you this. What was the plan? What were you going to do? What were you going to say?
When
you went back home.
I didn't have a plan. I just wanted to go home. I wanted to go home and act as normal as I could. For the time being, I didn't know what to think. I just wanted to die.
You said you wanted to die. Did you contemplate killing yourself on your return to Wairika?
Objection, Robbins.
Were you contemplating killing yourself as you were returning to Wairika?
I wasn't formulating plans to commit suicide on my return trip. But I did after that.
And I want to make sure we heard you correctly. You said you didn't formulate any plans on the way back home?
I wasn't thinking of it. I just wanted to die.
Okay. When you went to Utah and when you were going to go home back to Wairika, did you have injuries?
Yes.
What were those injuries?
I guess they were like scrapes and things all over my ankles. And I had cut myself downstairs the day before. Well, I guess it would have still been June 4th before we woke up. Before we went to bed, I was getting water in the kitchen. I dropped one of his glasses and broke it. And he didn't get really mad, but he called me klutzy. So I was picking up the glass, and I cut myself with the glass. So I had that injury, but it was, I guess, unrelated. But when I pulled over in the car, when there was blood on my hands, it had reopened, and it was bleeding a little bit. It was kind of, I don't know, it wasn't really a deep cut, but it was bleeding a little bit.
So, when you were in Utah, I should have asked earlier, when you were in Utah, did you formulate a excuse for this injury?
Yeah, I think I said I cut myself.
Okay. Any explanation how?
The week before, I cut myself really badly at work, so I think I just said, I'm a bartender, I cut myself. I think it was actually June 1st, I cut myself. I don't remember that because the date was on the photo in my phone.
Okay. Did you get back home to Wairika?
Yes.
Do you get there on time for your shift?
I think if I was late, it wasn't very late. I was there.
Okay.
I think I was late that day, but I made it there.
Do you work the rest of your shift?
Yes.
At this point in time, had you seen any of your family members yet?
Probably my grandparents. I went home, I think, and changed into my work clothes real fast and drove over to the restaurant.
Okay. When you got home, what did you tell your family?
I didn't tell them anything.
Just tried to live as normal?
Basically, I tried to act like nothing had happened and just waited for the clock to tick down.
What clock are we talking about? To your arrest?
Yes, that clock.
You said you got back in early June. And back to Wairika, and you were arrested in July. Did you ever contemplate or attempt suicide during that period of time?
Yes. Not attempted. I took steps to.
What were those steps?
I bought a gun.
When you say you bought a gun, where did you buy the gun?
It's called Don's Sporting Goods. It's on Minor Street in Wairika.
So you bought it at a sporting goods store. Did you need to get a license in California?
Yeah, California requires a 10-day background check and then for the gun to be registered.
Apart from buying the gun, did you take any other steps relating to killing yourself?
Yes, I began to prepare for, there were things that I didn't want to come out about Travis, or that I was participating in with him, and so I got rid of the clothes, the underwear, the boys' underwear, I got rid of that.
Is that the Spider-Man underwear?
Yeah.
Is that a yes, Jodi?
That's a yes.
And what else did you do?
Do you mean to get ready to commit suicide?
Yeah.
I was going to leave the area so that, I was on the fence about suicide. I wanted to kill myself, but I also knew that if I don't kill myself, I'm going to get arrested, so it's one or the other. So I decided to move. I was going to move back to Monterey so that regardless of which one came first, it wouldn't have to be in Wairika.
Why didn't you want to be in Wairika when either of those two events took place?
I guess I just thought that it would be easier if I was not, easier for my family if it wasn't right in their backyard, so to speak.
Either alternative?
Yes.
Now, apart from buying a gun, though, we know that you had several phone conversations with Detective Flores when you lived in Wairika, didn't you?
Yes.
Those came to pass after you learned from other parties of Mr. Alexander's death, is that correct? When did you make those phone calls?
I think I tried to call him on June 10th.
That was the first time you tried to speak with him?
Yeah, I left him a voicemail.
What prompted your call to Detective Flores on June 10th?
I think Leslie encouraged me to call then, call him.
Well, let me ask you this question. When were you informed that Mr. Alexander was dead?
Dan called me the night before.
Dan and who?
Dan called me and told me.
Yes.
I'm sorry, Dan Freeman, Daniel Freeman. He didn't tell me that he died.
Sustained.
I'm sorry.
He told you that Travis died?
He did not.
What did he tell you? Six-sided on our suggestion.
We're going to take the noon recess at this time. Ladies and gentlemen, please be back to the area 125. Please remember the admonition. You are excused.
Please stand for the jury.
Please be seated. The record will show the jury has left the courtroom. Ms. Arias, you may step down. Counsel, please approach. Please be seated. The record will show the presence of the jury, the defendant, and all counsel. Mr. Nurmi, you may continue with direct examination.
Thank you, Your Honor. Ms. Arias, before lunch, I think when I spoke to you about returning from Mesa, excuse me, from Utah to Wairika, you were still driving your rental car, is that correct?
Yes.
And did you return that back in Redding where you got it?
Eventually I did, but not on time.
Okay. You say eventually, do you recall when you were supposed to have it back versus when you did get it back?
Yes, I was supposed to return it the same Friday, and I ended up returning it on the Saturday instead.
And why were you a day late? Was this because of the time you spent with Ryan Burns, or?
Yeah, I overslept, and I underestimated the time that it would take to get from West Jordan to Redding. So if I would have cut over to Redding to drop the car off at the airport, it would have made me late, even later than I was for work. So rather, I just took the highway around the northeast side of Mount Shasta and went straight to Wairika because it was faster. But I called the car rental place first to make sure I had permission to do that.
Okay. So when you went to Wairika, back home to Wairika, what car were you driving?
From that trip, the rental.
Okay. And then you went back down to Redding and then back home again.
The next day I went to Redding. I think it was my sister-in-law that drove me to the airport and then back to her house where my car was parked at my brother's house.
Okay. Now, based on the timeline we've been talking about regarding your time in Utah, do you recall what day your shift was back, and this was at Casa Ramos, right? You're still working there?
Yes, Casa Ramos.
Okay. And what day was your shift on, what day were you scheduled to work, I should say?
That Friday. I think I was supposed to be there at 4 or 4:30.
Okay. So you say you went to your grandma's, changed, and went straight to work, right?
Yes.
Okay. And because of that schedule, you didn't have an opportunity to speak with your family before the end of that shift. Is that accurate?
No, I was in a rush. I didn't have an opportunity. I just ran home. I was already late, so.
Okay. And you were living at your grandparents at this time?
Yes.
Okay. And based on what you told us before, you had, at this point in time anyway, a pretty good idea that Travis is dead, is that right?
Yeah, it's something I wasn't accepting in my head, but obviously I kind of knew it. But I wasn't, like, facing it, if that makes sense.
You wanted to deny that reality, right?
Very much.
Okay. When Well, let me ask you this. On this point in time, did you have any knowledge of anyone else knowing of Travis's death?
No, as far as I knew.
Were you thinking, or were you fearing that that might happen soon?
Yeah, I assumed it was going to, and I was definitely not. I was definitely fearing that.
When did that fear become a reality?
I think it was early in the morning on June 10th, sometime after midnight. Dan Freeman called me, and I saw his name on the caller ID when he was calling my phone, and I thought that that would probably be the phone call that I was dreading, and I answered it, and he told me that something...
Based on that phone call, did you come away with the understanding that Mr. Alexander had been found dead?
That wasn't definitively said, but I assumed that was the case.
Did you... You said not definitively said. Did you seek out other confirmation of this?
Yes.
And whom did you contact?
Through Dan Freeman, I learned who was there, and I began calling. I called his friend, Travis's friend, Brent Hyatt. There was no answer, so I called. I don't remember if I called Zach Billings, his roommate, but I was talking to his girlfriend. She wouldn't say much, and then I was able to get Bishop Layton's phone number. That was the bishop to Travis's ward. I was told he was there, and by then it was like 3 a.m, and I called Bishop Layton, and that's when he told me.
Told you that Travis was dead?
Yes.
How did you react to that news, at least him telling you of that news?
Objection to relevance.
Approved.
When you received confirmation from Bishop Layton that Travis was in fact dead, how did you react to that?
I just remember I was in the living room at my grandmother's house on my phone, and I doubled over and started sobbing really hard. And I couldn't stand up.
Prior to you learning that information, hearing that information from Bishop Layton, was there still a part of you that was hoping that he really wasn't dead, that he was just injured?
I was hoping the whole thing wasn't real, that it was just a nightmare, and that, of course, I was hoping none of that had ever happened.
And when you heard that from Bishop Layton, that's when you realized that hope was dashed. Is that fair to say?
Sustained.
Was that hope that it was a nightmare gone after you talked to Bishop Layton?
Reality set in a lot more than that. I still, to this day, I wish it was just a nightmare. But I wasn't able to just deny it as much in my head, or it was more like facing me squarely and...
Can you describe, apart from facing you squarely, could you describe those emotions that caused you to double over?
It's more like things that were going through my head.
What was going through your head?
I didn't know how his friends had found him, and I thought of what everyone was going through. And I thought of Napoleon. I didn't know what to think. It was a disaster, and I just... I had to hang up with Bishop Layton.
After you hung up with Bishop Layton, what did you do?
I was scared. I figured I'd probably get arrested, like, the next day or something. And I was still trying to keep up the pretense that...
Sustained.
You said you feared arrest at that point. What was your plan? You talked about earlier about... Was this when you decided, well, I'm either going to kill myself or I'm going to move to Monterey?
No, I knew I'd get arrested or I'd end up probably killing myself. Around that time, no, I hadn't decided yet to move to Monterey, but it came like a few days later.
Okay. Well, we've heard earlier about your conversation with Detective Flores that happened on June 10th. Did you have this conversation after you spoke with Bishop Layton?
Yes, later in the day. It was like 3 in the morning that I spoke with Bishop Layton, and I think it was in the afternoon that I spoke with Flores.
Okay. You called him, right?
Yes.
Why?
Leslie encouraged me to, and I thought she said that
sustained.
Leslie encouraged you to talk. By Leslie, we're talking about Leslie Jodi?
Yes.
You had spoken to her after you learned of. After you spoke to Bishop Layton?
Yes.
Okay.
The next day, or later in the day.
Now, when you call Detective Flores, what? Obviously, you just told us, Leslie, Miss Jodi had encouraged you to do so. But beyond that, did you have your own reasons for contacting Detective Flores?
Yes.
And what were those?
I thought that if I didn't call him, it would look more suspicious than if I did call him. So in effort to pretend like I was never there, I called him.
Okay. Why not call him and tell him what happened?
I was scared to do that. I mean, I just couldn't imagine admitting to something like that. I couldn't even imagine doing something like that.
So you called him to act as if to begin putting up the facade that you had nothing to do with it. Is that what you're telling us?
Yeah, I began that facade almost right away because I didn't want anyone in Utah to know either, but that's why I called him also.
So to try to continue the facade that you began in Utah, you called Detective Flores?
Yes.
Okay. Now, we talked earlier about a gun you had purchased. We talked about suicide and about a gun you had purchased it. I believe you told us Don's Sporting Goods, right?
Right.
Okay. When, and you said you went through a background check and everything. When was it that you purchased that gun?
I think I purchased it on July 1st and took possession of it July 11th, if okay. I remember correctly.
And what kind of gun was this?
A 9mm.
Now, there is a lot of time between June 10th and early July, 3 weeks or so. Did you make any attempts to kill yourself during those 3 weeks?
No.
During that time period, you also made various calls to Detective Flores.
Yes.
Why were you continuing to do that?
A few reasons. One, I wanted to continue to act like I was participating. And two, I kind of also was calling him to see what information I could garner from him.
Because you wanted to get whatever sense you could of whether you're going to be arrested soon. Is that right?
Rephrase this one.
Would it be fair to say you were trying to see if your arrest was imminent?
I knew it was imminent. I just wanted to see how much, I wanted to try to determine how much time I had.
Given that you, what you said before about killing yourself and not seeking a gun out until July, you were living at your grandparents' house, you had access to guns, right?
Yes. My parents had guns also.
No. Did you ever contemplate using one of those guns to kill yourself?
No, the idea to use a gun to kill myself didn't really come to me until I had possession of the gun and I realized how easy that could be.
You said it didn't come to your mind until you had possession of the gun. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. So, it sounds to me like that wasn't the killing yourself wasn't the reason you purchased this gun, that there must have been some other reason. Is that accurate?
Yes, that's accurate.
Okay. Why were you choosing to purchase this gun at the sporting goods store?
Several reasons. My dad has always owned guns. Daryl has guns. Matt has guns. Most of the men that I've spent time with have guns. My grandfather has guns. It was something that I wanted to someday see myself being a responsible gun owner. And so that was something I'd always thought of doing. Around that time, in the spring, I was working at another restaurant called Purple Plum, and I made friends there. And one of those friends was going out to pan for gold. It sounds silly, but the Klamath River nearby has gold in it still. And we used to go out there and kick up the sediment, and you can see the gold in the water and all that. I was invited out there, and I wanted to go. It would also be a camping trip. At that point, everyone that was on board, except for me, were all men, and even though they were my friends, I didn't want to, I don't know, it just seemed like I knew they drink, you get out there in the middle of nowhere, you have a bunch of drunk guys, one female, I just didn't want to end up in a situation, so I thought it would be good to have the gun with me when I went there, just as general protection anyway, because I'm out in the middle of nowhere. So we were going to go out there and spend the weekend out there at the Klamath River, seeing what we could dig up or in the river, and just camp. And so that was another reason that I wanted to have it right then.
Why, what were you fearful of these people would do something to you?
Well, I mean, it was a bunch of guys, and I mean, I didn't feel as safe anymore.
Around guys?
Yes.
And you say anymore, you mean after June 4th?
Definitely after June 4th, yes. It was kind of a progressive thing, but I didn't feel safe at all after June 4th.
Now, after Travis's death was discovered by the rest of the world, were there services for him, funerals, memorials, things of that nature?
Yes, there was a memorial service at his church in Mesa, and the funeral, I believe, was held in Riverside.
Did you attend either of those?
I tried to attend both, but I only made it to the memorial service.
And that was the one in Riverside?
In Mesa.
Mesa. Given what had happened, why did you want to attend those services?
I thought that if I didn't show up, it would look suspicious because Travis and I were close, and a lot of people knew that, and he also told me one time that...
Why did you feel the need? Had you made a promise to him that you would?
The subject of my funeral came up one time. And he said, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Keep forgetting.
Abstained.
And you and Travis had an agreement that you would attend each other's funerals?
Something to that effect. He was going to give a eulogy or something if I ever died.
And keeping that promise or that deal still meant something to you?
Yes.
I'm sorry, Ms. Harris, what?
Yes.
Why?
Because he would have come to mine, and even if it was in Antarctica,
but Jodi, I have to ask, he throws you down on the floor, says, fucking kill you, bitch, and you fear for your life. Why doesn't that kind of conduct just kind of throw that promise way out the window?
No, I don't think so, because whenever he lost his temper, he seemed genuinely ashamed about himself afterward, and that's not the kind of person that I believed he was at the core of himself or who he wanted to be, so it wasn't like one of those things.
So you still viewed him as a good person?
Rephrase.
Is that correct? That you still viewed him as a good person?
I believed in him and that he wanted to be a good person. And
that's actually the only question. She was asked whether or not she did view him as a good person.
She's answering, Joe. She's totally responsible.
Overruled. Complete your answer.
I've seen very, very good sides to him. And that was the person that he wanted to be, and that's the person he wanted to embrace. And so, I mean, I've got sides that I'm not proud of, and he did too, and I just figured that's part of being human, and he had really good sides too.
By that point in time, had you forgiven him for attacking you that day?
By the time I went to the services?
Mm-hmm.
I blamed myself, so I didn't know how much there was to forgive, but I had this experience. It sounds silly, but I had this experience.
What was your experience?
I was at the Freeman's house in Gilbert after this service, and I was in the bedroom in the afternoon, just taking time out for myself, away from everybody. And I felt like he was there.
And what did that experience mean to you?
It helped me to know that he was okay and he was in a better place. And maybe that he wasn't mad anymore.
You You were at the Freeman's in conjunction with his memorial service?
Yes.
After you had that experience, do you forgive yourself for not escaping?
She was escaping.
She's already testified to that, Judge.
Judge, I make the objections. The way it works is I make the objections, you decide.
Counsel, please approach.
He testified earlier that on June 4th, you didn't feel like you could escape because of an incident in 2007 where he caught you running down the hallway. Is that correct?
Yeah, my intention was to run out of the room and I didn't make it out.
So in 2008, on June 4th, based on what you said earlier, you didn't consider that a viable option on June 4th. Is that right?
Objection made.
Sustained, rephrase.
Did you consider, at the time, did you consider escape and running away as a viable option when he was attacking you?
Not through the bedroom door. I thought I could run into the closet and he would, and then run the other way and then maybe get out. It didn't work out that way.
So going back to my question then, when you were at the Freeman's and you had this experience, had you forgiven yourself for not trying another option?
No. I didn't.
As we stand here today, years later, have you forgiven yourself for not trying another option?
Approach. We continue.
Jodi, ask my question again. As we stand here today, have you forgiven yourself for not finding another way out of the situation you found yourself in on June 4th?
No, I think that if I had just left before any of that happened, I have a million regrets. I mean, I was scared of him and I reacted, but I still, I will always regret everything about that.
Do you blame yourself for not taking some other alternative measures?
Yes.
You did then and you do now, is that right?
Objection answered.
Sustained.
Why do you still feel, given what happened on June 4th, why do you believe now that you realistically even had other options once it started?
Well, I don't, maybe if I hadn't, when I grabbed the gun, I didn't mean to fire it. It just went off and that made him even more angry. It, like, he just became this volcano. And so I think that if maybe I'd handled it properly, I don't know. Maybe he wouldn't have gotten as, he was already pissed off, but he was raging after that. And I think maybe if I had handled the gun properly and just, I meant to just point it at him, I thought it would stop him, then maybe he wouldn't have gotten as angry as he did. Maybe he wouldn't have threatened to kill me. I don't know. I have thoughts like that.
And those thoughts were with you after you learned, or you got confirmation from others that he was deceased?
Actually, no, I didn't know that he got shot until Flores told me.
Okay. But in terms of your life, the plan you made, you said that you called Detective Flores, and I'm paraphrasing, in an effort to act like you had nothing to hide. When you were in, living in Yreka, were you trying to put up that same facade?
Yes, I was.
Trying to act as if everything was normal?
Well, it depends on the time period. The first week, yeah, I tried to act like nothing had happened. And then when I talked to Bishop Layton and Dan Freeman, it felt like I had like more freedom to just let it out. At least my emotions.
Because it was known now.
Yes.
And you say let out your emotions. Apart from that initial outburst you talked about after speaking with Bishop Layton, did you have others?
Yeah, I did.
Several?
Usually every night.
Why every night?
Because at night I just lay there and think about stuff. And usually that's when he would call me. And usually when he called me late at night, he was in a good mood. And I just knew that my phone wouldn't ring anymore.
Once you had permission to openly grieve, did you tell your family what happened?
I told them that he died. I didn't tell them anything about me being there.
Did you tell them about the things that you've told us throughout your testimony, about the sexual things and about the violence?
No, I would have never said anything like that.
Why not?
Well, there's several reasons. One, anytime I said something negative about a guy, they hate him thereafter. Two, it's really embarrassing and shameful. Not just the sexual part, but just being in those situations. And it's, in order to understand why I wouldn't talk about anything negative, it's, I don't know if you've heard of, it was a philosophy that I had at the time.
What was the name of that philosophy, Jodi?
It's called the Law of Attraction.
Could you just kind of, before you talk about that and the effect and your world at that point in time, could you just explain to us what that law of attraction is?
Yes. I mean, you might have heard of it. There was a movie made about it called The Secret. And then after the movie came the book, and it was bestsellers all over. Anyway, so the law of attraction has been around much longer, and it was something that I had briefly studied when I was 19, 20 years old. When I met Travis, he was very much into that, which I liked. And so it became more and more a part of my philosophy and my creed. So anytime I would mention something negative, he would get upset and tell me not to focus on those things. Or one time when we had that really bad fight in the fall, when he wouldn't let me leave the room at first, I wrote about some of the things he said, and he found it in my journal anyway. I'm sorry.
Ask another question.
How did the law of attraction, you said Travis introduced you to this law?
Well, I sort of knew partly about it, but he introduced me to the movie that they made about it.
And that was The Secret?
Yes.
Okay. And from what you described, part of the law of attraction involves not putting forth any negative thoughts. Is that correct?
Yeah, it's like what you put out there is what you get back. You're not supposed to think about, speak about, read about, write about, talk about negative things. Otherwise, those things will be brought into your life more.
And what you were explaining to us is that Travis would assert that law as the reason for preventing you from writing negative things in your journal?
Yes. Oh. Yes, that's good.
And explain to us then, you mentioned the law of attraction and putting things out there. What was that, the meaning of that to you as it related to my question about saying anything negative about Travis to your family?
I never said anything negative about Travis ever to anyone, except one time with Matt. So I didn't want to say anything negative to my family about him either. I didn't want to say anything negative about him at all, especially now. I didn't want anybody to know those aspects.
When you say didn't want anyone to know those aspects, what do you mean?
I definitely didn't want, I promised I wouldn't say anything about his other issues, which I didn't ever want that to ever come out, but.
His other issues, just please, what are we talking about?
His, I don't know how else to call it, his sexual problems. And then I definitely didn't want anyone at this point to know the level of violence that had been in our relationship, because I thought that would be construed as motive to kill him.
Okay. Remember the day you were arrested?
Yes.
What were you doing on that day before you were arrested?
The day before?
No, on that day.
Oh, okay. Before.
Before you're arrested.
I was getting ready to move some things down to Monterey. I was going to be gone for a few days. So my dad took me to the south end of town to get a car rental at that time. I didn't have my Infiniti was gone by this point, so I couldn't drive to Reading and get a cheaper car rental. So he drove me to the south end of town. I got a rental, came back, put some things in the car. I still had some things of Matt's from like 10 years prior. So I was putting some of those in the car to give to him. He'd been wanting, they were old books. And I was just getting, I took a shower, and then my grandma told me that there was a police officer here, or at the house.
Let me ask you this. Do you recall this gun you bought at the sporting goods store? Do you recall if you had it in your possession at that time or not?
I did. It was in the car.
After you were arrested, we saw that, did Detective Flores arrest you?
I think Officer Potter put the handcuffs on me. I don't remember the handcuffs going on, but he was the one that came to the door.
Okay. But after you were arrested, you spoke with Detective Flores that day, right?
Yes.
At this point in time, on the day you were arrested, you've had several phone conversations with Detective Flores, right?
Yes.
And we heard evidence that you also went to the Mesa Police Department, gave your DNA and fingerprints. Do you recall doing that?
Yes.
Had you met Detective Flores prior to, in person, prior to the day of your arrest?
Yes.
Okay. When you were arrested, and questioned by Detective Flores, and that was the interview, you were still wearing, you were wearing a t-shirt and pants before you were took to the jail, is that right?
Yeah, jeans and a t-shirt.
Okay. Why didn't you tell him what happened on June 4th? Why did you deny being there?
The main reason is because I was very ashamed of what had happened. It's not anything I ever imagined doing. It's not the kind of person that I was. It was just shameful. I didn't want anyone to know that I had anything to do with that, because it's just, it's very much not me, and it was shameful. And I was also very scared of what might happen. I didn't want my family to know that I'd done that. And I just couldn't bring myself to say that I did that.
So on that day, based on what we saw on the tape, you made the choice to deny being there altogether, right?
Yes.
Were you thinking that that would make you appear innocent, or what was the thinking with that untruth?
It was more like, I mean, I didn't understand any of these procedures. I just have always heard, don't admit to anything kind of thing. That's what an attorney advised me to do. So I just denied it. I guess I didn't understand that I could just be quiet and not say anything at all.
Had you been interrogated by a police officer before?
No.
You speak with Detective Flores again the next day in Wairika. You recall doing that?
Yeah, first I talked to Detective Blaney and then Flores. Okay.
Now, when you spoke to Detective Flores on that second occasion, you told him you were confronted, weren't you, with evidence that in fact you were there?
Right.
Weren't you? Okay. Then you told him another lie, right?
Yes.
What did you tell him?
I began to tell him things that I thought would comport with what their forensics would show, as well as create a way for me to not have been responsible for it.
So in that regard, you tell him a story about a man and woman breaking into the bathroom. Why did you come up with this story? Why did your story include the idea that there were two intruders?
There were two people there that day. I don't know. It just seemed like, and everyone was saying, oh, one person.
You're saying like a foundation about
approach.
Why did you create a scenario in which two individuals conducted this attack?
Prior to my arrest, there were a lot of rumors flying around, and Flores told me repeatedly that it had to have been more than one person.
Why do you come up with any particular reason why you come up with a man and a woman for this lie?
It sounds a little esoteric, but I think it could have been symbolically like Travis and I. We were the ones fighting that day. I don't really know, to be honest.
Okay. You know, when you did this second interview, you had some time to think. And get your bearings. When you were creating this lie to tell Detective Flores the next day, did you contemplate telling him the truth?
I contemplated it. I wanted to, but I was nowhere near ready to tell anyone that I was capable of something like that.
Were you in a state of mind where you could have told Detective Flores everything, the sex, the lurid sexual interest, the lurid sexual behavior. Did you want to tell him about that?
No way. He's Mormon. It just was all the more shameful.
What about Travis? Did you still want to protect him, his memory?
I was very concerned about both of our reputations, and I didn't want to start throwing him under the bus, so to speak. I didn't want to say negative things about him now, because there were a lot of people already hurting, and I didn't see what benefit it would be to talk about any of those things.
What do you mean, what benefit? What benefit to whom?
To anybody. It would just cause more pain. I didn't see what benefit it would be to anybody to talk about these things now. I mean, this is stuff that Travis didn't want anyone to know about. These are things I didn't want to tell anybody about. I certainly didn't want to tell Detective Flores about all the times that he was violent, because then I thought that they would think that that would be motive. And I didn't want... Travis and I were... I considered us friends, and then when he got that way, he got that way, and then we got over it, and I didn't... I wanted to portray the appearance that he and I were friends, which we were when we were getting along. We were just fine, and then, like, that whole day was fine. And then it just flipped.
What about the benefit to you to telling Detective Flores the reality of what happened in your relationship?
I didn't see any benefit to doing that.
At this point in time, was Travis's image more important to you than your own future?
It certainly was. I didn't feel like I had a future anyway. So there's no reason to take him down, his reputation, just because I'm down.
What's that?
I didn't think there was any reason to start opening up that door when there's just no reason. I didn't have a future. There was no benefit to me. There was no benefit, certainly no benefit to anyone else to say those things.
You had mentioned earlier, in accordance with the purchase of the gun, and that you said, well, once you had the gun, you realized it'd be so easy to just pull the trigger. When you were saying these things to Detective Flores and in Yreka, did you have plans of killing yourself?
Yes, they weren't set in stone, but I really, really wanted to. I was concerned about how it would affect my family, obviously. But I just wanted to die.
Did you take steps to make that happen?
In California, after I was arrested, I did.
What'd you do?
At that point, I'm sorry, I thought you were talking about prior to my arrest, but I did actually decide I was going to definitely kill myself.
After your arrest?
Yeah, that was my idea. What I did was you can purchase different things in jail. So I bought a bunch of Advil. I'd had surgery one time in the past, and I was told by that doctor that not to take any Advil because it's an anticoagulant. So I thought, okay. I bought a whole bunch of Advil. I took it all over the next few days so that it was in my system. And they have razors there for shaving, double-bladed razors that you're allowed to just keep with you. And I took it apart one night with intentions of slitting my wrists. There are other inmates that work there. We're all housed together. It's a very tiny jail, tiny town, tiny county. And they work laundry. And so they would bring back tons of laundry for anybody. And so I had asked for extra laundry so I could stuff it around my body because there was somebody sleeping below me and I didn't want anything to like, I didn't want anything to get on her. So I stuffed it around my body and got under my blankets with my razor after everyone went to sleep. I never did it, obviously. I'm still here, but I was getting comfortable, and as I was moving around, I nicked my wrist with the razor on accident. It was more like a paper cut. It just stung so bad, and I sat there and I couldn't bring myself to do it, and I was really pissed at myself because I wanted to be done. I wanted to be dead before Travis's birthday.
Travis's what?
His birthday.
And what was his birthday?
July 28th.
July what?
28th.
Okay. So, am I correct then? Your thinking was, you're going to tell this story, doesn't involve exposing anything, and then you're going to kill yourself, and it's all just done. Is that right?
Overruled.
Yes, that way I would never have to admit to it, or my family wouldn't have to know that I did that, and everyone that loved him was going to believe what they would believe regardless. So I was thinking that there's nothing I could do about that, but just thinking more along the lines of I didn't want my mom to know, or my brothers or my sister.
Okay. Jodi, when you, apart from the police interviews, we've come to understand throughout this trial that you spoke with the media as well. Do you recall doing that?
Yes.
And without going into the details right now, did you reach out to them? Any media outlet, or did they reach out to you?
They reached out to my family.
And when we're saying they reached out to your family, who was it that reached out to your family?
CBS.
Okay. Was there a particular person that reached out to your family that worked for CBS?
Yes, his name's Jonathan Leach.
Did Mr. Leach, well, let me ask you this. Did Mr. Leach come visit you in jail?
He did.
And to your understanding, was it his purpose in coming to see you at the jail to try to get you to participate in an interview with him?
Yes. Well, not with him, but with CBS.
Okay. And did you decide to participate in the interview?
Eventually I did, yes.
Why did you? You said eventually. Did you initially decline?
My first instinct was absolutely not. I got a bad feeling, and then after contemplating it for a little while, they made contact with my family the very next day after I failed to kill myself. So I thought, maybe this is a sign that I'm meant to do something like that first, and then kill myself. I saw it as an opportunity, not just to... I mean, I didn't know... I hadn't told my family about these phantom intruders. I just thought they would eventually hear about it. And so I had friends and other people asking questions, or that maybe didn't even know about my situation. I didn't want to be known or remembered as somebody that could be capable of what happened. So I wanted to present a different picture of myself.
Judge, could we take a moment to approach?
Yes.
These... I'm trying to get... I'm hoping that you can give us a little better understanding. These media interviews you decide to do, or this initial interview you decide to do, you're trying, you believe you want this story out there in the public?
Well, there is more motivation than just that. Jonathan had told me that Travis's friends and loved ones were all participating, and it would just be their side if I didn't say anything. So there was that as well. I wanted the world to believe that I loved him and I didn't have anything against him, and that I wanted the world to perceive me as just a normal person.
Why was that important to you?
I don't know. I didn't. My reputation used to be very important to me. I think it had to do with a lot of the fact that I didn't feel very good about myself, and I portrayed one image to people of somebody who was responsible and mature and collected and sweet and nice, and behind the scenes I'm just falling apart, and I didn't want people to know that about me. I just wanted to get on there and just show people that I was not angry. I didn't hate him. Wasn't anything like that. And I also felt at that point that I made up this big stupid story for Flores and that I should stick with that. And I stuck with it for a long time.
Okay. So after this initial contact by Mr. Leach, do you have any idea in terms of time how much later you actually interviewed with him or with CBS?
It was pretty quickly after. I think it might have been in August 2008.
And then now, this initial, did you do more than one interview with CBS?
Yes.
Okay. The initial interview, where did that take place?
It took place at the Siskiyou County Jail.
And who was interviewing you then?
Jonathan Leach was.
Okay. You said that this contact happened, if I understood you correctly, the day after this failed suicide attempt. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
The contact, not the interview.
Right. Was the plan then to do these interviews and then kill yourself, or did the suicide get put on hold?
No, the suicide kept getting put on hold, but my plan was to not be around by the time it aired. That's my hope.
And after this initial interview, did you interview with 48 hours again?
Yes.
And was that with Mr. Leach again?
No.
Who was that with?
Her name's Maureen. I don't know how to pronounce her last name, but I could spell it.
Okay. Well, why don't you spell it for us if you remember?
M-A-H-E-R.
Okay. So if you speak to her, I'm going to use Ms. Maurer. Where are you when you have this interview with her?
By this point, it's September 2008, and I'm here in Siskiyou County, okay, at the jail here. Here in Maricopa County.
I want to ask you a few things about these interviews. Why in these interviews did you describe your childhood as almost ideal?
I felt it was.
Facts, not in evidence.
Rephrase, sustained.
When you were speaking with Ms. Maurer, did you describe your childhood as almost being ideal?
Yes.
Why?
I felt it was until a certain age. I have, I think, almost all good memories from age as early as I can remember until 7. I remember like one or two negative things. It was a great childhood up to that point. I had my brother, I had my pets. Like I said, I had places to play. I had lots of little friends at school, that kind of thing.
That was part of it, right? That idealness?
Yeah, that was part of it.
You didn't tell her the other part.
Well, I didn't want to say anything. I didn't want to say anything bad about anything, about my family, about Travis, about myself. I didn't want anyone to know about other negative aspects of my upbringing. And I sugarcoated everything that I said. Everything was rosy. That's how I said it.
Including your relationship with Travis?
Yes. I glossed over the negative things. I mean, they got a quick mention, but I glossed over them.
Were you asked during these interviews if you'd ever been physically abused by Travis?
Yes.
Do you remember how you responded to those questions?
Yeah, I wasn't specific. I didn't go into a lot of detail. I just said a few very minimal things and shrugged it off as nothing big, not a big deal.
Why?
Again, I didn't want people to know the level of violence that our relationship had reached at a couple of points, and I thought again that that would be construed as a possible reason for me having killed him.
Having what?
Killed him.
You mentioned, well, let me ask you this. During these interviews with Ms. Maurer, the sexual aspect of your relationship, do you recall whether the sexual aspect of your relationship was spoken about?
Yes, it was.
Why was it okay at that point in time to talk about those issues with Ms. Maurer?
Well, I didn't go into detail with those either. Just, I knew there were some things that were already known and in evidence, and so I figured, well, I'll just give them a brief mention because she had asked about them. They were in police reports or things, something like that, that she had read. So I didn't tell about all these graphic things that we'd done, or I just sort of hinted at it like we were just two adults and things were consensual and it was what it was.
You said that certain things were already known. Are you referencing the pictures that Detective Flores showed you during his interviews with you?
Yeah, the pictures that were found on the camera.
The naked pictures of you?
Yes.
During your phone calls with Detective Flores, you also admitted that there was a sexual relationship between you and Mr. Alexander, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
Why did you do that at that time?
I thought that it would establish that I knew him very well, that we were close, and that, I don't know, that I just, you know, that I might be able to, I don't know, I wanted him to know that I was close with him and that we were, I didn't want him to know that we were like having, doing all this stuff, but just that there was no malice there.
Had you, before you told Detective Flores, after June 10th when you learned about Mr. Alexander's death, and the time you told Detective Flores about your sexual relationship, had you confessed that sexual relationship to other persons?
Yes.
Why did you choose, the cat was somewhat out of the bag as it related to your sexual relationship. Why did you choose to minimize it during all these interviews?
Well, because I didn't want to get explicit. I mean, I confessed to my bishop and, I mean, it wasn't a secret, but it wasn't widely known either. And I also didn't want, I just didn't want people to know, like, it's embarrassing, really, is why I didn't want to get into detail about it.
To your understanding at the time that you spoke with Miss Maurer, were there, did the evidence exist about the Spider-Man underwear? Did the text messages exist about him calling you a whore? Was any of that stuff, to your knowledge, something that anyone knew about?
I didn't think anyone would know about the Spider-Man underwear because it had been months since we had texted about that or talked about that. I knew that some of those mean emails were still in my account. I didn't know about his. I figured they would be found eventually. So, I mean, I didn't have any knowledge of them knowing about it at this point, but I assumed they did.
Earlier in this trial, we heard the phone sex conversation you recorded with Mr. Alexander. Was that on the phone that you had in your possession while you were arrested?
No.
So to your belief, no one knew about that either, is that correct?
That is correct, yes.
Okay.
I didn't know about that tape.
Right.
I hoped. I didn't know where my phone was.
What's that?
So that was my hope.
Okay. Anyway. why do you continue when you speak with Ms. Maurer? Why do you continue the, what we call the intruder story?
I wanted to remain consistent with what I told Flores, and I certainly was in no place in my head to admit to any involvement.
Recess. Please be back in the jury room at 3:20. We will start promptly at that time. Please remember the admonition. You are excused.
Please back to the jury.
Please be seated. Ms. Arias, you may step down. Counsel, please approach. We are in recess. Ms. Arias, please take the stand. Please be seated. The record will show the presence of the jury, the defendant, and all counsel. Mr. Nerme, you may continue.
Ms. Arias, before the break, we were talking as it relates to these interviews and your discussions after Travis's death was discovered, that you felt to some degree, as it relates to the interviews, and we were talking to some degree how the cat was out of the bag as it related to your sex life with Travis, right?
Yeah, it was more than out of the bag. It felt like it was under a microscope at that point.
Okay. The dirty little secret was out.
Right.
And why, you said you had told others about your sexual relationship. Do you remember who you told?
Yes, the first person I told was a mutual friend, Aaron. Is his name?
Okay. And why did you, well, prior to this, you told us about some comments you had made to Rachel about sexual activity that you minimized. You recall telling us about that?
Yes.
And then, well, when you spoke with Aaron, did you also minimize the behavior?
No, Aaron wasn't, he was a church member, but he wasn't living the standards of the church, so I assumed that by sharing this with him, he wouldn't judge me, that maybe he was in a similar boat, so to speak. And I also was still seeking advice, and I was still hesitant to go to my bishop based on the discussion I had with Travis about that.
But once he had passed, then you felt more comfortable? Is that what you're telling us? Talking about these things?
I would have never talked to Aaron about that if, you know, I didn't want anyone to know about that. But he wouldn't judge me, is what was my thought.
Okay. Did you interview with any other media outlets besides CBS?
Yes, I did.
And don't have to know the parent company or anything else, but do you remember who that was or what show that was for?
The show was Inside Edition.
Okay. And were you contacted by them or did you contact them?
They contacted me, I guess you could say. I certainly didn't contact them.
Okay.
Indirectly, they contacted me.
What do you mean indirectly?
I was just hanging out one day in the housing unit in the jail, and an officer came with two shirts saying, which one do you want to wear? Inside Edition's here, and they want to talk to you. And my attorney at that point had advised me not to do that because it could...
Sustained.
So after the officer gives you the shirt and you say you go What happens after the officer gives you the shirt?
Well, she didn't give me the shirt right away because I didn't want to do it at first, but I was encouraged to. I was encouraged to because I'm just trying to think how to word it. I'm sorry.
Okay, well, let me ask you this. Did the officer encourage you to speak with them?
Yes, she did.
And we're ultimately talking about a law enforcement officer, correct? Sheriff?
She worked for the sheriff's department. She was an officer.
Okay. So when you describe the situation with Mr. Leach, it appeared he came and met you and talked to you about why you should interview before there were any cameras. Is that accurate?
Yes.
Okay. The gentleman from Inside Edition, do you remember his name?
I think his last name was Boyd. I don't remember.
Okay.
His first name.
Well, okay, we'll just, the reporter for Inside Edition, did he come meet you and without cameras and try to discuss whether or not you should participate in an interview with his television program?
No, it was just sprung on me.
Okay. So the videotaped recorded interview you saw was the first contact that we saw earlier, was the first contact you had with Inside Edition?
Yeah, the first and only.
Okay. Now, when we began your testimony some days ago, we talked about a quote you had said, and I'm paraphrasing a bit, that no jury would ever convict you. Do you recall that?
Right.
And earlier you described those as being the bitterest words you'll ever have to eat when we began this testimony. Do you recall that?
Yes.
Okay. Let me first ask you this comment, no jury would convict you. Why did you say that?
Objection, ask that answer.
Overruled.
Well, you can't convict a dead person, and I planned to be dead long before this ever even got close to trial. That was my hope.
Why did you choose those particular words?
Well, I didn't watch very much TV prior to being arrested. And then after I was arrested, it was on all the time in the same room where I lived. And so there was a TV program on that everyone was watching. And a lawyer on there was talking about a case that they were trying to get somebody indicted. And the prosecutor said, no jury will convict. And the way she had said it was very powerful and it impacted me. And it just stuck in my head. So By this time, I think I'd already done the CBS interview. I was similarly confident in that interview that there wouldn't be a conviction. I didn't tell her why, obviously. And then, so by the time this interview came along, it came out more, I thought, more eloquently and more forcefully and more assuredly. But I obviously couldn't say why, because the officer that had escorted me to that interview, the one that encouraged me to do it, would have escorted me elsewhere afterward.
Okay. Now, at this point in time, since Mr. Alexander's death was discovered, you told one version of events in which you weren't there, and another version of events where intruders came into the home, killed Mr. Alexander, and you escaped. Why did you then now decide to tell us what really happened?
Objection, vouching, what really happened? Telling us something.
Feigned rephrase.
Why did you decide to come forward? All these things that you've been hiding. Mr. Alexander's sexual interests. The sexual relationship. The violence. Why did you feel comfortable coming forth with that information?
Objection, indicating that she was hiding this assumes facts, not in evidence. He started the question by saying...
Overruled, you may answer the question.
It wasn't an overnight decision by any means. From day one, there was a part of me that always wanted to, but didn't dare do that. I would rather have gone to my grave not without confirming that I could have done something like that. I was extremely ashamed of it. It wasn't in line with who I was or how I had been living my life all the way up to that point. So as the years went by, however, I began to... It feels very fraudulent from day one, especially when there are so many nice people reaching out to you and they believe you or they believe in you. It just feels... It doesn't feel right. It feels fraudulent. It feels wrong. My family also remained very supportive and told me that it doesn't matter what happens, we love you anyway. And I realized at that point that even if I told the truth, that they would still be there and they wouldn't walk away. So it was around, it evolved, it was a process that happened over a long period of time, but by the time the spring 2010 rolled around, I confessed.
You what?
Confessed.
Well, you say confessed, what do you mean by confess?
I basically told everyone what I could remember of the day, and that the intruder story was all BS, pretty much.
That's all the questions I have, Judge.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to ask that you go back to the jury room. We will be with you shortly. Will show the jury has left the courtroom. Please be seated. Ms. Arias, you may step down. For those of you seated in the back of the courtroom, we are going to be handling a matter in a closed proceeding for the rest of the day. Court will convene again tomorrow morning at 10:30. We are in recess. Counsel, I will see you in chambers.